Good morning, friends. As we gather together, if you're grabbing coffee, we encourage you to make your way to the sanctuary. We're so glad to be together this morning. It's good to see your faces. Let's pray as we gather and as we center our hearts around God this morning, as we think about what we're going to learn about. So, Lord, we come to you. We ask that you would be with us this morning, that you would be with us all of our days, Lord. We ask that as we praise you, as we lift up our prayers to you, as we lift up our petitions, Lord, as we ask questions and grow deeper in our faith, God, we ask that your presence would draw near and give us hope, that your presence would draw near and comfort us. Lord, we ask for healing of relationships, of bodies, of our homes, Lord. We ask for healing for our neighborhoods and our communities, Lord. And Lord, we pray that you would use us in that healing, that you would show us and teach us how to be more like you, more compassionate and courageous and loving, Lord. So God, we come to you to declare our praise this morning. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand together this morning. Our praise to you, God. That's what a life is with you, Lord. You've made us new. You've set us free from our chains, Lord. 'Cause you broke my chains of sin and shame, but you covered me with grace. 'Cause you mend my life with your holy fire, and you cover me with grace. And you are the hand that reaches out to say, I am set free, Lord. Continue to worship you with our hearts, with our minds, with our lives. We ask that you'd reveal to us. Maybe there are chains that are still holding on. There's still things that we are struggling to hand over to you, God. We ask that you'd break those bondage, Lord. Break those chains that hold us down. Whether it be sin or a broken relationship, Lord. Whether it be something that causes us fear or pain, Lord. You long to be with us, Lord. Let us sit in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we are no longer enslaved by these chains. We reach out to you, God. asking for your spirit to hold us close in your presence, God.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone.
I'm no longer
a slave to fear. I am a child of God, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
From my mother's womb.
You have chosen me.
Your love is called.
Love has called my name.
I've been born again.
And to your family. Your blood flows through my veins. Oh, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God.
I'm no longer
a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Let's sing it again.
I'm no longer a slave to fear.
You've made us new, Lord.
I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
You made us free, Lord.
Child of God.
we are thankful that we have this opportunity to know you, that we have the chance to be honest about where we're at, Lord, that sometimes we struggle, that sometimes we fail, but that you are a God that constantly makes themselves available to us, Lord. We ask that you would hold us close this morning, to give us courage and encouragement to be more like you each and every day. So as your sons and daughters, Lord, we ask that you would bless us this morning. And all of God's children said, amen. You can go ahead and be seated.
Well, good morning, Starting Grounds Church. Good to see your faces this morning. Glad you're here. We'd love to connect with you on a Sunday morning. There's cards at your tables or at your feet. If you have prayer requests, want more information about the church, we'd love to hear from you. Fill those cards out. Drop them in the offering boxes at the exit doors on the way out. That would be fantastic. Hey, today is we have a Raptors game going on, Ridgefield Raptors. There's some of us that are meeting there to watch some baseball this afternoon. That's at 1:05 p.m., so pretty much right after the service. This is our last game of the season, I believe, last home game at least. So if you've been wanting to get to a game, come join us. You can go at ridgefieldraptors.com, purchase tickets, $7 in the grass berm. There's no more. Okay. Sit in your car and watch the game from the parking lot. No. There's probably seats that you could purchase for a little more, but like $14. So, you know, if you want to come to the game, join us. It's just going to be a great time. Bring a chair if you are in the grass berm, and snacks, and cheer on the Raptors, okay? Family camp coming up in 2 weeks, okay? This is the last full week to get registered for that. We got to start purchasing food and things of that nature, so if you want to go, make sure you get there. That's $40 a person, $160 for a family of four or more. So if you got 20 in your family, it's $160, right? So, but hey, there's some sign-up sheets right outside these double doors. So I encourage you to hit those up on your way out, just volunteering for breakfast setup, prep, tear down, snack list, no talent, talent show. That should be full by the end of the day, okay? I've already saw Billy Bob signed up, so he was here and gone. I didn't even see him. It's crazy. But, man, that's it's going to be just a great weekend, so hopefully you can join us at family camp, and you can register online at startinggroundschurch.com, okay? If you have any questions regarding registration, talk to Megan. She's sitting right back there. She'd love to help you out. Okay, coming up at the end of this month, too, we're going to have another swim party at the King's House. Teenagers, teens, where are you? August 27th, that is a Friday, okay? So that week, there's no youth group on Thursday. We're bumping it one day to Friday, and then that's going to be kind of a back-to-school swim party. Excited about back-to-school, anybody?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay. So parents, just note that in your calendars, August 27th, okay? Also, we have a class coming up here at the end of August. We do classes here at the church from time to time, and these usually fall. Is it falling on a Sunday evening? Sunday evening. So 6 to 7:30, that's intro to the church. So learn and discuss church history from first century Christianity to today's church. So you can register for that as well, okay? And we are a member-supported mission here at Starting Grounds, and what that means is if you consider Starting Grounds to be your home church, that you would just be faithful in your tithes and offerings and your talents and your energy and all those things. We just thank you for your partnership in that as we continue God's mission here at Starting Grounds. And you can give in the offering boxes, you can give online. We don't pass around a plate here, but those are different options just to give. So would you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much again for being in this place. I pray that your presence would be known here this morning. We just commit this service to you. Be with Pastor Ben and God and the kids as they go to their classes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
These days, even kids get tempted to do bad stuff.
So let's talk about what to do when you're tempted. Get ready.
When was the last time you were tempted to do something wrong? Like watch a TV show that you're not supposed to watch, or sneak a snack that your parents told you not to eat.
The Bible says that Christian kids don't have to just give in to temptation. God is there to help. Memory verse. He will not allow the temptation to be more than you can stand. When you are tempted, he will show you a way out so you can endure.
Endure is just a fancy word. It means you can keep honoring God even when you're tempted.
So here are four steps you can take to endure.
Step number one, take your thoughts captive. Did you know that your thoughts don't have to control you? You can take control of them and shoot them down.
Bad actions start with bad thoughts. So grab those bad thoughts and take them captive.
We take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ.
Step number two, run away from bad things. It's not enough to just think the right thoughts.
If you're in a bad situation, you gotta run away.
For example, if your friends are playing a video game and you know you're not allowed to play it, get up and leave the room, or just go home altogether. Don't just sit there and do nothing. Remove yourself from the temptation.
Step number three, chase better things. If all you ever do is run away from the bad things, then you're always focused on the negative. Don't forget to focus on the positive. Fill your life with pursuing better things, like reading your Bible, hanging out with good friends, going to church, and, of course, obeying your parents.
Step number four, tell somebody. Secrets are bad. When you're tempted to do something wrong, you should admit it to a parent or friend. Letting others know about it will help you to be strong.
Let's do an experiment.
This balloon represents you, and the bottle represents temptation. Put a little fire in there, and it'll suck you right in.
You can try to get out of temptation on your own, but it's just too hard. Now this straw represents God, and with God's help, you can get out of temptation.
Pretty cool experiment, huh?
And it reminds you that God helps you out of temptation.
Good to see you today. Oh, I'm so thankful that we have that straw in our life, God, that can help get us out of tempting things. We all fall into temptation, right? Yes? All of us. It happens. None of us are perfect. No, of course. But when it happens, we had some good things to remember. Our thoughts don't have to rule us. We can take them captive. I liked seeing the little finger guns up here taking them down. It was good. Well, each week we have a joke. I've got a joke teller today. This is my daughter, Emily, and she wanted to tell a joke because here in a couple weeks, it's going to be Move Up Sunday, and if you're going into fifth grade, you're going to the middle school class, so she's going to be one of our kiddos moving up, so she wanted to tell a joke today. Here she goes.
What do you call a man with a rubber toe? Roberto.
A man with a rubber toe. Roberto. I love it. Very nice. All right, so if you are in kindergarten through fourth grade, you can line up at the back door with our wonderful Miss Melinda and Gigi. And also if you're in middle school, Pastor Jason and Miss Jennifer will be at the double doors. Ooh, I love it. Sounds so full and good. I love it. All right. As our kiddos leave, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are there for us, even in the times that are not our most proud, Lord. Thank you for loving us in the midst of all of the things that our minds tell us to do. Thank you for loving us, Jesus. Be with us today. Give us ears to hear and hearts to listen. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Love all the kids and the teens. Love it. Yes. Oh, it's so good to be with you guys as well. I'm sorry. My heart goes with the kids. I get when Jesus says, let them come to me. It's like, yes, this is life. How many of you guys have ever gotten caught up in life and felt just twisted, and then your kid reminds you like, oh yeah, it's not that bad? Or maybe it's the opposite. Maybe it's, oh man, you just made it worse. Okay, so. But we're good to have a great group of kids and teens. Thank you, Lindsay and Jason, for your ministry. And so we're grateful for those things. Before we get going into our series and continuing our series with power and kind of into that, I need some preparation for a future series, and I would like to ask for your help, if that's okay. We are going to be doing a series in the future here, near future, as the fall sets in, called Ask, Seek, and Knock. Scripture says that if you ask, it'll be given to you. If you seek, you shall find. Knock, and the door will be opened. And so often we want to be those people, if we name it, we claim it, and sometimes it doesn't quite feel that way, does it? But I think there's something a little bit more ancient to this process, and I think there's something that we want to kind of explore what it means for us to ask. First of all, we do really a poor job in the church to not allow many questions, right? We don't allow questions into the church because, you know, hey, that we may not have answers for that, so let me just tell you what to do rather than bring the questions about. So what I'd like to do is create a series where we build a series based off of your questions. And we'd like to hear what you are struggling with, what you're wondering about, what you never really understood about either life or God or faith. Maybe there was a story that you read in Scripture, you're like, I really don't know what that is all about. Perhaps there are some things where you're like, yeah, but kind of things. I know God is this, but maybe there's some things that just don't really make sense in the real world, as we would say. I'd like for you to consider, what are the questions of faith that we would want to know, that we want to seek, that we want to knock, we want to experience what God has for those questions? Can I have a disclaimer that sometimes there's not really a clean answer? If you spend any time with me whatsoever, I have a tendency to not give clean answers. Sometimes you'd be like, Ben, what time is this? Well, it just kind of depends. You know, sometimes we start on time, but really a lot of times, right? And you're like, just give me the time, man. I exhaust you, I know. But it is for a reason, because I want you to understand more than just that life is not just clean answers, but we have exploring to do. That seeking isn't just a data download and then suddenly we just go and do. But it's an ask, a seek, and a knock. So, well, this is what I'd like for you to do today and for the next coming weeks. If you're listening and watching online, you can participate as well. You can message us on our Facebook group. You can put it in the comments, flag us, call us, however you want it with your questions. But if you're here with me today, would you maybe pull out your phone? Maybe you have my text, my number. You can text me a question. Perhaps you want to be a person who takes one of the Connect cards and write your question down and put it in one of the red boxes and we'll get it placed there. But based off the questions that we have, we will design a series on what it looks like for us to actively seek, knock, to ask those questions, to create a space where we're okay with dealing with things that are not necessarily clean and easy, or things that may not necessarily have an exact answer. But I do think God gives us truth, and I do think that God helps us with those things. Maybe there's that scripture that you just don't quite understand. So if you would, sometime today, in the next few weeks, we'll need those as soon as possible, basically because I probably don't know all the answers. Shock. Right? So I probably have to study, and we have to talk about it and figure out what those answers are and how to best present it to you. So if you would help me to build this series that will be following up at the end of the month. We want you to be excited for what God is doing. And last week we had a great thing. Thanks, Troy. Thanks, Jake, for joining us up on front. We talked about parenthood. Yes! Right? And we learned that kind of a lot of what they were sharing is that sometimes we learn that parenting isn't as in our control as we'd like it to be. We feel the pressures of the lives of these young people in our hands. And yet, sometimes we as believers, that it's more about releasing to God and letting God nurture and nurturing what God is making. There's a difference to that. When I think about parenthood, sometimes there's that old Roman practice of exposure. I don't know if you know this, but back in the day, a child would be presented to the dad, and it would be laid in front of him, and if the dad picked it up, it was then named and now cared for. And if it wasn't, it was generally set away in the river or would starve to death. Thank goodness for practices not like that anymore, correct? I think it's interesting that we have a people, a kingdom that rides on that story, which is kind of interesting. And it may not be a direct correlation, but I think it's interesting that one of the fathers of faith was left in a basket down a river, not out of exposing of him, but out of care that he may live. And we see God cares for them. So today, as a parent, when we think about Moses being sent down a river in care and how God was faithful to care and nurture him, may you as parents feel the freedom to know that God is going to nurture and care for your children. And that our actions should show something of care and nurture. Sometimes that's counterintuitive to what we want, isn't it? Which was what we talked about last week. Today, we move into a different type of world where we start talking about the slave and master mentality. Paul begins to talk about masters and slaves and how they're to interact in this mutual submission. And my question to you today is, what is the hardest thing about your work? If you're sitting with your boss, it may not be a good, open, safe place for you to share. But I'd like for you, as a table talk for those around you, to share what are some of the hardest points about work. Maybe it's not your current job, but maybe it's just work in general. What is difficult about it? What are some of the challenges that just make it not quite as fun as you thought it would be? And so if you would, if you're online, you can comment through the chat. But if you were here in this room, would you just kind of turn to the people next to you and share what one of the hardest things about work is for you? It may not even have to do with exactly what you do. It may be just that you have to do it. Maybe it's the time. Maybe it's the late hours. Maybe it's the less pay. But what are some of the things that are the hardest things about your work? Ready? Go. Great to hear the chatter. So glad that you are able to express what it is that the challenges are of work. C- Can I be honest? I was worried that you wouldn't have anything to share, that you were all people who just love work so much. That work just is this pure joy. Yes. It's good to know that I'm not the only one who sometimes work is just simply that, work. What are some of the things, the challenges that you had heard as you guys are tailing down? What are some of the things? Early wake-ups. Man, why can't I just start when I want to start, right? Yeah. Long hours. Yes. Man, some of you are working some major hours, aren't you? Yeah. Oh, rules are not the same. Favoritism in the workplace. Same on paper, but not in the real world, right? Yeah. Left for interpretation, yes. Yeah. Feeling valued. By your employer, yeah. Feeling like, oh, yeah. Man. Portland traffic. That's right. Portland traffic. That's one of the hardest things. It's not even just getting to, it's not even working, it's getting to work, right? That whole, I think I heard somebody, just the whole like getting up and having a shower and put on pants. Man, I miss COVID. No, I'm just kidding. No. The getting a home from work, yes, because you just want to be there. Yeah.
Not having full control
over other people, right? Yeah. So it'd be easier if people just agreed with me, yes, and did what I needed them to do. Yeah. How many of you guys are in a workplace where you have to rely on the other person, or you're often held up on your job because of somebody else? Anybody? Yeah. Yeah. It's like, just get it done, right? Yeah. Or get it done right so I don't have to do it again. Yes. What might play into the favoritism are the cliques, right? If you're not part of the center crew, then challenges come about. Yes. Yeah, you're the forgotten ones. Yeah, we live in a world where work is not easy. There's challenges into it. And although we're reading from a scripture that specifically is talking about master and slave, can I tell you that it's not a very far jump from perhaps some of the things that we may feel. And now, I'd like to think that you're not getting lashes or your life is not lost if you don't do your job, but I think that we can start to draw some correlations to slavery and masterhood into our current situations here today. And so we have to kind of take some time when we read into the scripture to know that this is to an ancient people who have a very ancient context that isn't necessarily for our Western contemporary world. But can we walk away with something? Can we walk away with something to understand at the root of slavery is perhaps something that we fall into as well? That maybe it's not necessarily systematic, although there are times where I look at the systems and I go, man, there's some people who are not getting paid the way they should. We look at this and we are called to a bigger people. We're called to not be part of the world of the empire, but we're called to the people of the kingdom. So Paul writes not just to the husband and the wife, the parents and the children, but he also talks to the slaves and the master, the employee and the employer. And so, let us venture into the scriptures as we read here today. It comes from Ephesians 6, verses 5 through 9. It's going to be on the screen, or you can follow along in the Bibles in front of you or on your apps. And this is what it says. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear. That's more of a reverence fear. And with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor in their eye, or when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ. doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not people, because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whatever or whether they are slave or free. And masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master is yours in heaven. And there is no favoritism with him. No favoritism. Amen. Let us pray. God, help us. Help us to kind of grab a hold of this in ways in which we may see that you are actively working. May this not just be a what I need to do, but what we do and how we approach the world. May we leave here with a deeper level of mutual submission. And so, God, as employee, employer, would we find a way in which we honorably, faithfully serve and obey you in ways that treat one another with great respect. We love you, God, and we pray these things in your name. Amen. Bosses are the worst. Amen?
Amen.
In fact, just recently, the last few years, I kind of have become a boss, and I can't even look at myself in the mirror. Yes, a boss is sometimes the worst. Sometimes it's the greatest thing, too, isn't it? So, how many of you guys have ever had that great boss that you stayed in that job simply because of them? Yes, we've been there. But I've had some crazy bosses before. Yes, I've had some different ones. I remember as a college student and kind of my first years of ministry, I worked at a place called General Nutrition Center, GNC. Yeah, I was your multivitamin guy. Yes, I told you what you needed. Yes, I used to work at the one over by MCRD and people would come straight out of boot camp, 40 pounds lighter, because of all the work that they did. And they'd always come in and they said, man, I need to put on weight. And I just knew, I was like, it was like shooting fish in the barrel. Yeah, you need this, and you need this. And they would just, here you go. But there was bosses that I had to. I liked the job. It was something to do. But sometimes dealing with the bosses, the managers were difficult. I had one boss that was always stressed. How many of you guys have had that one before? Like you had to talk him off the cliff every time he walked into the door. It's going to be okay, John. John, it's going to be okay. God, you know, I've got your back. You have to reassure him that we are going to do this together. I had one who literally walked in the first day, said, hey, my name is Mike. I'm your new manager. Went in the back, 10 minutes later, grabbed a bag from behind the counter and started putting stuff in the bag. He said, hey, man, I've got to go take off. I'm going to pay for these tomorrow. And before I could even process what was happening in my mind, he walked out with hundreds of dollars of product. And I went, what just happened? Just to let you know, I never saw him again. I had one boss. She was a nice young lady. She was a couple years younger than me, but she refused to share how old she was. She was afraid of not being respected. And she was so much wanting to be the authority of that place. And oftentimes I had to remind her, hey, you don't have to fight me. Like, whatever you need me to do, I'll do. Like, I'm on your team here. And she allowed that stress to wear her to the point which one day she began to speak words that weren't making sense. And I had to help her. And I said, do you know where you are? It got to that place where we had to call in authorities, and she actually was having somewhat of a nervous breakdown. Bosses can be weird, but they can be great things too. Being an employee can be weird too. And we've had employees that are not as good either, are we? That it doesn't work when the employee is about themselves, or that you always have to convince them to do their job. I mean, you guys have been there before. That you feel like you have to always remind them that there's a job to do and why we do it. How quickly we fall into this place of slave-master mindset in our workplace. And what I mean by that is that that although there are rules and there are rights that we have in our country today that don't allow us to necessarily be totally forgotten, although we are forgotten, right? That on paper, favoritism is not there, but it's there. That although we have these things, there are still these levels in which we create the workplace into this master slavery type thing. I began to study kind of what this process of slavery and mastery, masterhood kind of looked like. And it wasn't enough for me to just look at our American history, but I looked back into the Roman Empire. And I began to read about what this empire began with. And I don't know if you know this, but in 700 BC was kind of the roots of the Roman Empire. And it didn't start with a master world power. In fact, you know how it started? It started as agricultural herdsmen that kind of band together under a king. It was under a monarchy. And in the midst of it, a lot of these workers began to raise up arms to not just care for their land, but for their neighbor's land as well. It was very noble and secure. So, of course, they would get in skirmishes with other people, other lands, and they would begin to acquire different places, which when you acquire new land, you acquire the people that inhabit it. This began to be a thing that helped prosperity and goodness, because what it allowed them to do is now they could have them work and do things for them to help make the dream work. In many ways, this prosperous stuff, it began to be a thing that war and compiling land was this thing that now there was a profitable way to have war. Now that not only do we have security in our homes, but when we take over something or when we secure a land, now we can make profit out of it. That demand is higher because now we have more people to feed. That we have people to work those fields and we have people to work those different demands so we can have more product to go through. How many of you guys already feel like we're talking about our normal product here? That it's about more factories and more this. The downfall is what you see in Rome history is that when it becomes a republic, that they begin to fully expand across the world, which becomes this overwhelmed of affluence and stagnation. In other words, at some point, expansion became actually the fall of Rome in many ways. Because what would happen is they would acquire more people, and then they would have tradesmen, they would sell the slaves, and then they would also put them to work. But what began to happen is the people who built Rome, the agricultural herdsmen, now no longer could survive because the farms and other things were now getting too difficult to manage. Now the Rome could basically, the empire could just put slaves there to work the ground. Farmers weren't needed anymore, so they would move to the city. And then there was bad agricultural things. Now they had untrained people tilling the ground, which became poor crop. There's a number of things that began to happen in the Rome Empire that by the first century, you had this massive power in the world that was built upon a slave empire, that a lot of their prosperity was working because they had people who they enslaved. The tough thing is, at that point, when it became unmanageable and there became the affluent who now the slaves began to serve them directly, there began to be more riots. Now, instead of building the empire, the slaves were actually partnering up, creating these gangs and other things within the people. The people who were not the affluent, who were not the proud, who weren't the rich, the one who were gaining the profits of the wars, they would begin to rise up and become to eat into its own country. The land in which they used to love at the very beginning was now the place in which they wanted to destroy. I'm not making any kind of correlation here other than that there is something about the nature of slavery here that just puts a bad taste in our mouth. And Paul is speaking into a people who have a very foundational thing of this slavery. By the time Paul is speaking to these people, it was just part of the world that you just owned slaves and you just had people who worked for you. It was this employer-employee thing. They didn't have rights like us, and so you could sell them. You could trade them. They were property. If you didn't like their work, you could beat them. You could probably even take their own lives. But there was something about Paul who says, this is more than just about us saying no to the violence or the autonomy of the individual, that those are creatures and creations of God, but he saw the destructive value of the slave masterhood that was going on. That when they played into the hierarchy of the empire, it was a destructive value to the whole community. And he didn't want this to transfer into this whole process in which he was trying to get the Jews and the Gentiles to come together as one. He knew that if this same mentality just kind of said, well, we're one in the Jews and Gentiles, but we run our households the same, he knew it would become destructive. That it really required a transformation of everything we did together. That it wasn't just Jews and Gentiles coming together, but it also changed how they looked at their employees, their slaves. They approached it differently. And even for the slaves who were God-fearing, the people who were Christians, they had to look at it differently as well. There had to be a mutual submission to one another in certain ways, in which allowed them no longer to profit off of slavery, but to mutually survive with one another, to thrive together, to make the teamwork make the dream work. You see, for the Roman Empire, war became the place in which they began to profit. It ignited war and it profited off of it. And that in that expansion, it began to become this giant animal in industry that built the bricks of that whole kingdom, that whole place, until it couldn't do it any longer. You see, in Scripture, there's this word called doulos, which is the word for slave. And in fact, Paul even uses this when he writes to the Romans. In Romans 1:1, it says, I, Paul, a servant, doulos of Christ. In other words, he even uses the word slave. I'm a slave of Christ. I love the fact that Scripture kind of gives us this little tiny book. In fact, we generally look past it because we don't even know how to say it correctly. But then we also, it's like a page long. It's a letter to Philemon. And Philemon essentially is addressing one issue. That one of his servants, one of his slaves, somehow interacted with Paul while he was in prison. And apparently Philemon, this slave stole from Philemon. Of course, the slave, Onesimus, became a Christian. And so he's essentially writing to this other church leader, Philemon, to say, hey, I'm going to send Onesimus back to you, but I ask that you would receive him back not as slave, but as brother. And that whatever he owes you, I will pay back. The interesting thing here is Onesimus, the word in itself means profitable. We see this in Scripture, the fact that Onesimus is this actual word that personifies slavery. Profitable. Perhaps the way we approach the world is not in how we profit on it, but how we coexist with one another. That we as the church aren't about profit, but we're about living a kingdom. Is it possible that we're not about an empire, but we're about a kingdom-building people? I think about the Israelites who are in Egypt in the days of Moses, who were enslaved. And what did they say that their job was? It's to build bricks, to build the empire of Pharaoh. So if we're called to something else, if we're not to be a people of profit, what are we as a church? What does this mutual submission really help us to do? Perhaps this mutual submission helps us to build the kingdom that God wants us to do, one that's not going to be self-destructive upon itself, that has the ability, in which we've seen through our power series, that God's people become explosive and manageable, and it becomes expansive. I think it's interesting that no matter what empire has come, as you heard last week from N.T. Wright's website, is N.T. Wright says that kingdoms or empires have come and empires have gone, but the word and the message of Jesus still goes on and on and on. There's something that is everlasting about what we gather here for today. And so, what does it look like for us to lean into mutual submission in our workplace? In other words, sure, we have bills. I think I've heard some people say that. I think I heard my wife say that I love my job, but I don't like that I have to do it so that I can pay bills. The call here is not for us to separate ourselves from that system, but it's to change the ways in which we approach it. That how easy we can boil down our job for just simply because I have to pay bills. We strip ourselves of the joy of what God is doing in the midst of our work. That there is a ministry happening in that. And there's some things that we have to do to be able to change that mindset. It's not pulling ourselves out of that system, but what does it look like for the kingdom to be built within the empire? This is not for us to revolt against the empire. It is not us to become the authority like we've talked about in our series, right? This power of authority, it's about us being explosive and dynamic in the empire. Some things we learn from the scripture, it says, approach one another as approach your heavenly master or your earthly master, right? As if you're doing it for Christ. And it says, masters, approach your slaves the same. Why? Because their master is your master. We must realize that we have one master. And some of you might be saying, hey, bro, pastor, my boss ain't no brother or sister, right? They certainly aren't Christian. I think we're missing the point there. I think that's a call that goes beyond, because who's to say that they won't be a brother or a sister? Who's to say that they won't see what is going on? But there is something special that happens when we become under one master. That your employer is not who you serve. You do a service for them, but it's somebody you do not just out of duty for them or just because they see what you do, but it is for Christ, for what God has called and done in your life. If you have employees, your job is to not approach them just because you can profit off their work, but it's to say, see that they have bills and that they are dynamic people who are needing this work. It's important for us to see that the master that we serve is not that of man, but it is that of God. I know that's difficult for us to approach that in, because it's easier to get caught up in the master we can see than the master we can't see. One of the things that I also see that helps us to fall out of the enslaved mindset and more into a freedom mindset of the kingdom is that we approach our job about community contribution. And I don't care necessarily what you do or how minimal you think it is, but you play a part in building the community. Have you ever thought about that? how quickly we sometimes think, well, it's just a paying job. It's just so I can go live my life. But what you do helps build a community. It helps things work. It's part of the dream, right? It's part of what helps things to happen. And we in our world, we sometimes get so focused on what we are doing rather than focusing on why we are doing it. Take a couple who's trying to find that date night, right? You get a babysitter, you finally have that free evening, you haven't seen each other all week because you've been working, and you go, so what do you want to do? I don't know, what do you want to do? Let's go to a movie. Well, there's nothing good out, right? Like, how many of you guys have had that conversation before? What if you approached it not necessarily what do you do with your date night, but why you want to have a date night? What if it was more of an approach of, well, let's identify why we want to go on a date night. What is the purpose of it? Perhaps it's more of a thought of, because we want to connect with one another. How much different do you approach that date night if it's about connection? Because how easy is it for us to be like, oh, let's just go see a movie. You sit in the same room, next to each other, watch a movie, and then you go home. But what if you approached that date with, I want to connect with you? It's not about what you're doing, it's about why you're doing it. And how quickly in our culture we just get in the habit of, well, that's just what we do, or that's what I do when I go on a date with my wife. But what if it was like, I'm going into this, even if it is in a movie setting, I can approach that movie differently than just simply saying, well, we went on a date, check it off the list, let's move on. We are data hounds in our culture, aren't we? We like clean, simple answers, and we like to be people who says, I checked it off the list, now let's move on. We like to go into our work like that. Well, I did everything that I was supposed to do, I'm done. What if we approached our world and our work not so much about what we are doing, but why we're doing it? You now have to ask yourself, is there a larger purpose for what I'm doing? Can I encourage us to see that we don't just serve a master who's going to give out his orders, but he's going to be more of an atmosphere type person? Sometimes the will of God is not take this job or that job. Sometimes the will of the Father is, what does it look like for you to change the lives of others? And then he's calling you to determine how that works. How easy it is for us to be in the enslaved mindset of the empire of profitability. How many of you guys have had two job offers? And your immediate response was, well, this one pays more. How many of you guys have ever taken that job that pays more and found out that was a very bad decision? Yes, we found ourselves even more chained and more enslaved. What if we approach the other way in which says, what is it that I'm about? Why is it that I do what I do? And then approach my job and my place in that manner. That I don't care what I do, as long as I'm doing this, that's what matters. It's important for us to see that we serve one master who's not going to just be about profit and what the numbers are, but he's going to be talking about something of how you're going to change and affect the world. And the other thing that I would like to point out is this idea of slavery. And that not only goes with profitability, but that our value only comes with what you produce. And that's something that's very rampant in who we are. We see this in the story of the Israelites, don't we? That the value of those Israelites under Pharaoh's hands was that just a matter of how many bricks you can make. If you don't break bricks, you're not valuable. Yes? You're not valuable to me because you didn't build off of me. I didn't profit off of you. We're called to a different type of kingdom. We're not part of the empire. We're part of a people who's not necessarily about the profit or the product. but the purpose. What does it look like for you to lean into the idea of true rest? Pastor Megan asked me the other day, said, when was the last time you had a true Sabbath, a true day off? And of course, I've had moments and times of day off, or moments in which I got to relax. But a true Sabbath, I could only think of times, my natural response was to think of, when did I go on vacation last? That my natural reaction was, the only way I can detach, or the only way I can get rest, is if I totally detach and escape. Because if I'm here and not doing anything, my worth escapes me. How many guys, some of you are like, amen, I'm quitting tomorrow. But sometimes you're like, what if we detached ourselves from the empire that says your worth is only what you produce, to something a little bit more different of saying your worth is simply because you're loved by God. Whether you produce today or not, your worth still is intact. It's important for us to see this. I love this podcast that I'm listening to, Bema. I really encourage you to listen to it. But it gives a lot of Jewish context. But if you think about the Sabbath for the Jews, when does the Sabbath start? Sundown. Which, to me, I never thought of this very much other than, well, they wanted to get a head start. I thought of it more like a plane ride, right? Like a car ride. Like if you start at night and sleep halfway through, then maybe, you know, the pain won't be as long, right? No, because their day starts with rest and not production. What if we became a people that were about rest rather than production? That you approached your job not about what you have to produce, but you approach because you are rested and well, and your worth is intact, whether the job is done or not. This doesn't mean that you just don't do the work. This is not an office space mentality where you kind of get the spell over you, and you kind of just forget. I don't know if you guys remember that movie. I always love the consultants, Bob and Bob. So, we see you've been missing work. Well, I can't say I've been missing it, Bob, right? Right? Like, it's not that kind of mentality, but it's a mentality that our rest is in the power and the eternity of Jesus, and the ways in which when we approach our job, it's like, yeah, man, I'm going to do the best that I can. And when my boss is on me and attacking me and telling me I'm not good enough, I know that my worth lies in something else because I've prepped myself in ways in which I can be non-productive and still be worth something. So this balance of doing your best, serving as Christ, as if you were serving Christ in your workplace, but then to know that when you fall short, that the sufficiency of His grace is for you, that you are good enough, that you are worth, despite what the boss or your pay says and tells you. Can we be a people who are no longer about empire building? That's about profit and production. But can we be a people who are kingdom building, who lean a little bit more into the idea of purpose, community building, in a point which we are able to rest, knowing that our value is in something greater than what this world tells you? What if we began to work in a workplace where people said, you seem to approach this job a whole way different? We have a gentleman in our church, and I won't name him because I didn't get to talk to him about this. But if I'd speak long enough, you probably would know who I'm talking about. But he's a man who works very hard at his job. He's worked for the same company for years and years. And this man goes through the same struggles you and I. He's had children that have made their own choices. But one of the things I love about him is that not only is he about doing the best he can, but that whole workplace comes to him and says, there's something about you. That they seek him out to hear his voice, to hear what he has to say. And if you know who he is, you know that when you ask him a question, you better get ready for an answer. There's an amount of peace that comes to him. He's not about building an empire. He's not about having the biggest and best. He's not trying to make his own. He's simply living in a workplace for a master that puts his worth in exactly just of who he is and not what he can offer. My question to you today is, have you too long have approached this world in an enslaved mentality? Have you approached this world as that I'm only productive, if I'm only productive, then I'm worth something? Have you fallen into the idea that you have to profit from something to make it worth something? Can I invite you to come over to this side and see that we're called to be kingdom builders? The ways in which we don't look at what we're doing, but we see why we're doing it. And we find every way in which we can do that so that we can serve a God who gave himself for us. That we graciously and greatly give back to him. I'd like you to close your eyes and bow your heads. And I'd like for this to be a time in which you begin to ask yourself of, God, why is it that I do what I do? God, I know what I do, but why? And I'm sure the answer doesn't give you a raise or take away the bills or the stress. But can you lean into the idea that God has placed you there for a reason? That even in some of the darkest of places, the places that are all about profit and empire, the kingdom can be built right in that place. Where not only do you get to serve Christ in that workspace, but now you get to share what the kingdom has to offer. Share that their value isn't anything more than what God has designed them to be. God, I pray that these people would leave here encouraged, that these people would leave here not in a lackadaisic kind of way, but in a restful way. That our hands and feet would move with intention, and not in the ways in which we want to be productive, but ways in which we want to move in purpose. God, if we're in places in which we are working and we have only worked because it's something that's profitable or something that is all about us producing our own value, help them, Lord, to step back and to rest. Help them to see that the day starts in the night. That their love for you and your love for them is intact, whether they produce or not. May that truth be something that just digs deep within us. And as it digs deep and roots itself in our hearts, may it help us to move into our workplaces ways in which people go, that is not what I have experienced in this world. May we be ambassadors of your kingdom, God, in ways in which the empire, as it crumbles, may you help us to build your kingdom. Show people that there's something light and good and everlasting, that you are good and true, So we submit to you, God. We submit to your will and your mastery, so that as we serve one another and the world around us, you would be evident and our value will be intact. We love you, Jesus. We pray these things in the name of Christ, the one who was and is and will always be.
So may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this week. Go in peace, friends. Have a great one.